you all for coming for this personal meeting, and I'm very happy that you all got together. And we had an incredible talk this morning at 10:30, which was very exciting. Maybe perhaps Evyeta will tell a little bit about it. But as a host of the Truman Institute, we're very happy to host this meeting. One of our major projects for the past 2 years has been religion and peace, which is actually unlike the, I would say, the usual convention that if we'll separate religion from conflict resolution, everything will work out fine. We think exactly the opposite. We have to integrate religious leaders within conflict resolution, and this is what we are trying to do. And this talk is a part of one component among many in this project.
Okay. So thanks everybody for coming. I'm very happy and honored to introduce to you Kenpo Sodargyel Rinpoche, who's the head of the Larungar Five Sciences Buddhist Academy in Larung Valley, in what could be called Kham Tibet or Sichuan China, depending on the point of view you want to take. And Kenpo gave a very kind of moving talk this morning. And I think maybe I'll repeat the introduction I gave there, because I think it kind of maybe worked to give a sense of... So the way I introduced him, I think the main part was to say that he's the spiritual heir of Jigme Puntsok Rinpoche, who founded the Larungar Institute. He's a very, very widely acknowledged and respected teacher. He was. He died, you said, 14 years ago, I think, right? Mm-hmm. Coming from the Nyingmapa tradition of Tibetan Buddhism. And he himself, Jigme Puntsok Rinpoche, was a reincarnation, considered to be a reincarnation, of the teacher of the 13th Dalai Lama. Now I lost his name again.
Lerab Lingpa.
Yeah. What was it?
Lerab.
Yeah. Lingpa. And then Kenpo, in his talk, actually explained that they trace, I mean, he is known as also one of the students of Padmasambhava, who is the Guru Rinpoche. He's like the founding figure of Tibetan Buddhism in many ways. 8th century. So when Jigme Puntsok Rinpoche would go, say, on pilgrimage to some place, this is from his talk. For me, I would say that maybe the top highlight of the talk, right? So he would go to pilgrimage to places where he was with his teacher as a previous incarnation. And then he would discover treasures. If you guys are familiar with the Terma tradition of their treasures that Padmasambhava, the great teacher, deposited in different places in Tibet, in the sense of rocks and stones or people's minds. And so he would come to these places and he would remember the verses, he would remember the teachings, and this is what's called, it's a very important textual tradition, revelation, you could say, Tibetan Buddhism. So, I mean, thinking from Tibetan Buddhism, it's coming very, very, very deep spiritual depths, you could say. And so this is the kind of presence that, right, that is with us today. And the talk he gave was very much kind of geared to kind of take a different look at life, right, than what I guess we normally take. Or I mean, he's pretty much he framed a lot of what he had to say in the morning in relation to how he would think about things in science, and what's rational and what's not rational, and taking reincarnation as a very kind of maybe simple and serious fact about life, which is something that maybe we're not capable of doing so easily, but so just to say something about a different kind of way of thinking, which may not which could, may not be less reasonable or more reasonable than what we're accustomed to practice around here. But so just to kind of frame what, so the title, the idea of our talk today would be to speak about the relation between scholarship and experience. And this topic was chosen because Buddhism and academic scholarship share very much in common. But then they part in maybe certain places. What I think they share in common would be, first the interest in scholarship and study. Buddhism, sometimes contrary to the way it's normally thought of, is a tradition that's couched in very, very deep scholarly practices. But specifically it's analytic and it's critical. It's very critical of the way of human mind it tends to fantasize and attach very much significance to certain kinds of fantasies. And it's very analytic in the sense that it's always looking, taking things apart and looking at the conditions that cause things to move. So I think in those senses that there's a very kind of a pragmatic orientation, very similar. But then Buddhism Buddhism is very clear about scholarship being meant to be transformative, to change or to have a positive effect on the way people live in the world, on the way they perceive their reality, on the way they understand themselves or the lack of themselves, maybe. So there's a very different from at least one of the ideals that I think that we're supposed to hold on to here in the university of some kind of detached scholarship, knowledge for the sake of itself. Rather than for any kind of, it's not supposed to, any time we get involved emotionally, then supposedly something's gone wrong. Mm-hmm. And even though maybe none of us who are like professional academics in this room would necessarily say that that characterizes the kind of scholarship they do or they believe in, nevertheless, I'm not sure we have another ideal. And in the state of things today, in the 21st century with its fast pace, it seems like we may need to kind of begin thinking in those directions or think more in those directions. And so I thought it would be a good opportunity to hear some of Rinpoche's insights on these fields and take it from there.
首先我要表达一下今天我们有这样的一个圆桌的平等的还有一个面对面的有信仰的没有信仰的大家都有这么一个不同的思想和不同的习惯的人坐在一起有一个共同的求知和求真理的这么一个交流平台吧就很感谢这个杜鲁门研究系。我今天下午呢可能讲的不多主要是多听一下大家的这种不同的声音但要求让我讲一下刚才相关的几个内容的话首先是我想讲一下那个学术跟那个现在的这种这个体验之间的这种差别就也就是说我的有一些看法包括我去学校去寺院去一些各种不同的人的接触的过程当中在这方面我还是感受比较深现在好像那个学术界跟那个修行体验呢就是就好多地方是完全是不同体系的比如说一些宗教徒呢他对学术就并不是很了解甚至很排斥有些就研究人员就是他对这个修行的一些体验甚至呢就是把它当作是一种迷信就是所以好像这个研究跟这个修行就体验呢在不管是东方西方就是在很多范围当中是就完全是这个水火不容的感觉其实我觉得这两者呢就是相辅相成的就不可缺少比如说 我们一个宗教的这个修行人，就是他的这种要体验的话呢，一定要最开始的时候有一种非常严谨的这种学术的这个交流啊，就是包括我们这个藏传佛教当中有很长时间的这种辩论，就是这样的话呢，就是可能牵出了所有的坏意，否则的话呢，一般修行的很多体验都是最后就是从坏意的这种迷雾当中是没办法就是做出来。从学术这个层面讲，应该也需要，就可能是最好是自己有一些修行的这种体验，尤其是他们研究这个宗教，就是宗教领域的很多东西是这个心理的领域。心理的领域呢，就是如果没有去自己去信自，自己去修行的话呢，我看到这个西方有些学者就是一辈子就研究，但是呢，因为他自己的从来没有去实行，从来没有体验，就是最后的话呢，好像是我们从对宗教比较专业的角度来讲呢，就是很多学者他们所研究的这种方法上呢，就是因为他根本没有任何的信仰，没有任何的信仰情况下呢，他去做的有些事情呢，就是可能会不一定能照到，就是所需要的，就是真正的这种这个就东西或者是经历。可能这边是本身是有宗教的这种地蕴，就是就几千年的这种，也许可能会哈，我这边的情况不是很清楚。但是西方有些学者呢，他完全是有一种科学的这种领域来观这个我们宗教的这个各种仪式啊，或者说是各种信仰啊，包括心灵的这种状态的话呢，我们就觉得是。就可能自己没有就进入的话，好像就是光是依靠文字或者是依靠几本书，也没有老师带着的话呢，就好像他们的这种体验跟那个学术呢，就是完全的是脱节。虽然花了很长时间，但是我感觉上有时候这个效果呢，就是不一定很明显。就是西方有些国家确实这样的，这种学者比较多。因此我就感觉，如果一个人他既有学术研究的这种精神，也有一些修行体验的话呢，就是可能最好不过的。即使他没有的话呢，应该是就是有一些涉及到主观意识的这种这个信仰方面的道理，跟客观这个现实生活当中的这些现代的这个知识两个结合起来的话呢，就是可能需要有一种互相了解啊，尊重啊，就是这么一个平台。否则的话，比如说我是一个这个宗教人士，我可能在我的意识当中所得到的这些经济很重要的。我是一个科学家的话，那我从实验室里面就是得到的这种实验的结果很重要的。其实每个人都有他自己的一种这个成就也好，就自己的一种最好的这种体验，但是呢互相的也许是不承认，就是这是我想提到的，就是第一个观点。第二一个呢，就是我们这个宗教对这个和平进程当中的一些可能作用吧。就因为现在这个大多数的这个世间人呢，有些认为是可能宗教就是不但对和平进程没有很大的利益，就是反而可能会导致一些不太好的这种影响，就是也有这种信法。就但我个人的是这个与这个观点是完全相反的。我们这几年也是在有各种宗教的一些，也在泰国、在拉荣、在香港都开了一些各种不同的这个宗教，就是我们把这个话题呢，就是作为有时候是作为各个宗教就是对幸福的这种解读，就有时候是和平的这个解读，有时候是对可持续发展的，就是等等，就是不同的。在这个过程当中呢，其实每个宗教从这个教义的角度来讲呢，就是应该是对人类的和平就是有非常非常大的这个作用。只不过呢，就是这个宗教呢，有时候是可能我们人们就是把它就是拉入这个民族啊，拉入这个政治啊，拉入这个经济啊，就这个时候呢，好像就是这个宗教就利用出来，利用的时候呢，就是它就变成了比较狭隘的这种思想。有时候我看到这个人类的历史呢，应该是比较血腥的，因为从这个自古以来的人类历史一番的时候呢，里面有各种各样的这种冲突啊，各种各样的一些这个矛盾啊、战争啊，就是这样发生。 但有时候认为呢，我们的这个历史呢，应该是带有这个，有些学者认为是人类的历史是一个宗教的历史，就是也有这种说法。那么未来就变成什么样呢？就是大家大多数人来讲是一个未知数。但不管怎么样，就是我认为有信仰的没有信仰的，就是大家都是应该是对这个和平进程，哪怕是一点点的这种作用呢，就是都要去想尽一切办法。因为21世纪呢，就是跟以往的任何一个世纪比较而言的话，是比较和平的。实际上，我们在座的各位都是非常有这方面的思想，有这方面的这个研究，那么在这个过程当中呢，就很有必要，就我们这个宗教也好，或者说是学者也好，按照我们大乘佛教的这个思想的话呢，就是这个利他，今天有些教授也在讲这个将来这个大乘佛教跟其他佛教之间的有什么差别，就其实我们这个大乘佛教就是指无私的这个利他是大乘佛教的这种究竟这个思想，所以按照大乘佛教的真正是利他思想的话呢，无论是你有没有信仰，就是自己是在善良的这个心态当中呢，就是你的思想、你的创作、你的所有的行为呢，就是帮助我们这个人类的这种和平。其实这样的这种行为呢，就我觉得是在我们人世间当中是最有价值的。还有一个想补充的呢，就是我们这个现在也好，过去也好，有时候是给大家做的这种宣传或者是广告呢，就是没有什么可信赖的。有时候我们可能政治家就是他依靠到达他的目的来，他可能会触化就是某个民族某个这个团队，有时候是他那个就是经济就是为了到达他的这个目的的话呢，就是他可能会赞美，过于的赞美，或者是这样的。有时候是宗教徒呢，也是为了到达他的目的的话呢，他也可能有各种这个带有颜色的一些宣传。我觉得这些都是不是正向的，就是应该是所有的，就是一切，就是人们就是有一些到达自己目的的特意去宣传的这种行为的话呢，历史上也是这样的。我们这个人类做到今天是有经验的。
Emphasize the point. Well, going back to the issue of scholarship and practice, we have to be very critical being in academia. This is our second, even our first nature. But if we have, as it is offered, to have a subjective understanding of religion coming from religious practice, how can we be critical?
其实批判性的思维呢也很重要，很重要。像我们这个佛教里面有一句话，叫做怎么讲的，我当了上帝我们在世界上了，我们当下刚才日本的比赛电脑的各种本子，就是说就佛教里面有一句，我不站在这个佛教的这种这个立场，也不站在这个其他宗教的立场，只要跟哪一个宗派当中有这样这个符合真理的话，我就把它当作是最好的这个我的依据或者我的依靠处。所以真正的这种批判性的思维呢，就是我觉得是在宗教当中呢，就是也是很重要。其实如果没有批判性的话，可能我们这个科学今天当中的人类的今天的发展呢，就是不应该有的，就是要推翻，就是很多就是旧的这种或者说是不符合的这种观念，就是这一点呢，应该说在就是从中世纪以来，就是可以说是人类在这方面有个很大的这个进展。但现在西方呢，就是有一个过于的这种批判性，就是过于的这种批判性的话呢， 尤其是消费主义者，消费主义者他想到达这个自己的目标，就是所有这个人们心里的一些信仰也好，所有的这些神也好，就是抽象的这些东西全部都打掉，就是然后人们都要一心一意的享受，就是他的这种财物。我觉得是这样的，这种批判主义呢，是可能对人类的这种整个将来的价值观不一定适合。我觉得现在的这个经济消费主义的一些思想，应该是东西方铺天盖地，而且他们有一些目的是全球的所有的民族的这种民族感呐、宗教感呐、信仰啊，全部都是统统的，就是大小，就是然后完全的拼命的，没有任何约束的去享受。如果人类到达这样的，再过可能几十年、几百年，也许可能。人类都觉得是特别的这种，就很可惜。那个时候要建起来我们宗教和一些传统上面的这种价值观，那个时候可能不一定见得到的。
Question on Nisim's. Does he feel that there's something particular about Buddhism that calls for a combination of practice and scholarship, or does he feel that this is true for all religions in the same way? And if it is, then should scholars only study their own religion because that allows them to also be practitioners?
其实每个人那个，我觉得是。他有自己的这个信仰的话呢，就是信仰就是或者说是修行呢，就是对他带来非常大的作用，在他的世界当中。如果这样的话，不一定是这个佛教里面就是唯有的，或者说是某个宗教当中唯有的，他就每一个人，就像我们东西方的这种每个人的这种生活方式不同一样的，就是他这种宗教呢，就是对他有一定的这种利益。但是这个基础的话呢，我觉得是一定要有个很好的研究和这个学习。就是比如说我是一个佛教徒，如果我不，现在很多佛教徒把那个佛教的基础打不好，就直接去修，就这个是个很危险的。然后我作为一个佛教徒，我可能既要了解就是其他宗教的这种教理的话呢，对我修行有帮助，我又要了解可能对这个科技时代的就是各种各样的就是真实现象的，除了我们宗教的信仰以外的真实的物质世界的一些现象，这样的话可能对我有好处。所以我认为呢，可能各个宗教都有自己的不同的特点，但在这个基础的话呢，一定要有一个很好的这种坚固的知识，是否则的话，很多都我们佛教认为叫做盲修瞎练。
So, I kind of like the formulation of the subjective and the objective at first, as kind of complementary fields, right? The inner and the outer, and the religious and the scholarly. But then I wasn't sure it really works.Because, I mean, maybe thinking through Buddhism in a certain kind of way, Buddhism is talked, then Buddhism is supposedly about the inner. But then, I mean, if you think of, say, Abhidharma or anything, you know, religion always has a claim about what the world is. And I mean, I don't know, thinking of Judaism, it's very much about, just as an example, I think true for all religions, it's very, religions are very much about orienting yourself in the world, outside, not necessarily about anything, about any kind of inner cultivation.
You mean Judaism?
Judaism, I mean, I think, as an example, I think generally about religion, it's a matter of there's no universal laws. I don't know what you think about that, but Naftali or somebody else can have fun. But just to say also that, I mean, I ask, you know, my colleagues here, you know, if, I mean, supposedly we're doing something external, right? But I don't know, we're transformed as we go along. Hopefully our students are.
Something that has troubled me a lot in the past, and I hope you don't mind a personal question. It is easy to think up a situation where an intellectual or an aesthetic experience from a culture distant from one's own has a transformative effect on oneself. I can think of some examples in my own life, and I'm sure many people can. But is there, have you had an experience, either a ritual experience or a different religious experience with a culture other than your own, that had a transformative effect on the way you perceive your religious truths?
我不是特别清楚就是这个话题的最深深的内容，但是我可以再以我的观点来可以说明一下这个问题。其实我个人就是并没有就是包括我以前刚开始的时候，我学过心理学，学过一些，当时的这个就是一些辩证法，就是我还没出家的时候，还有一些学过一些就其他的知识。但后来我学了佛以后呢，就刚才他提到的这个阿毗达摩里面呢，就是对这个心识的分析就非常非常的透彻。就后来我对那个心理学的有些观点呢，因为心理学我特别感兴趣，但是呢在越学越有点迷茫，就是后来我看到这个佛教里面有上阿毗达摩和下阿毗达摩有两种，这个一个是大乘思想，一个是小乘思想，但这两个论点呢，就是我对那个原来的这个心理科学呢，就是好像有一些很大的这个转变。我现在的这个心理的这种思想呢，就是应该是阿毗达摩的这个对心识的这么一个观点。但我想说的是，一个是从学术界可能很难能了解到，就是有一个有信仰人的内心的世界。比如说有一个信仰的人，他在某个圣地或者是某个他祷告的地方呢，就是他获得的内心的这种世界呢，通过学术来从客观事实来研究的话呢，觉得这个是可能很难得到的。但是这个修行人呢，就是他确实是不管是学术界承不承认，就是他内心世界的改变呢，就是是真实存在的。刚才我们两位教授也在探讨这个事情，就是你们像耶路撒冷的这个比较特殊很神奇的这种圣地的加持，包括我们藏地有莲花生大师的很多的非常，我今天上午讲的堪布精密喷出去的时候的有一些神奇的这种力量。但是这样的一种特殊的神奇的这种力量的话呢，也许可能现在这个科学呢再怎么样讲也是是就不一定就是给大家得出一个特别满意的这种这个答案，就是这个是可能学术界跟我们这个信仰者之间呢就是比较不同的这个地方。不知道你问的是不是这样。
I think that what I'm hearing can be engaged in two ways. One is a dichotomy for people who are not people of faith, people who are not religious, between the academic and the spiritual. And another is for those who are people of religion and faith, within themselves, in their own scholarly study of their religion and their own experience. And I think that I think most of what you've been saying has been engaged in the first way, but there's also the second. I mean, I'd be interested in what you have to say on that, but I'll just give as an example. In Judaism, as a religious person, when you study, the height of success is when you come to a new idea and then you find someone in the tradition said it before you. And you try to convince yourself that what you're saying is what they meant, even though you know that there's something new in how you're thinking about the idea. In academia, so the ego is you're taking yourself away. You're trying to put yourself into the tradition. You're not somebody else. Whereas in academia, the idea is to create your own existence as opposed to the past. To the ego is very central, necessarily. Within the religious person, not as a secular.
So you put people into categories. One is religious and one is non-religious. And then you think the kind of people that Kempo was talking about is mostly among the scholars who don't have religion and trying to study religion. And now your question is, what about a religious person who is in the academic field? What's his view about their, how they could balance the study and the experience?
Right, because if it's about the importance of involving faith, spirituality with scholarship, then that's mostly a critique of people who you think are outside, right? And trying to bring them in, mm-hmm. and to get them to involve. But even when you're inside, mm-hmm. there's a lot to explore, mm-hmm. in the relationship, mm-hmm. between experience, mm-hmm. and thought.
Okay. 我认为那个现在学者就是没有信仰宗教，没有宗教信仰的这个学者，就他们的这个研究呢，其实最好是有一些包括什么这个历史啊，就是人类的这个有很多的这个经济政治啊，就这些没有信仰都可以。但是如果要有一些信仰的这种学者的话呢，可能他研究的这个比较深的就是心灵这个层次的一些呢，就如果没有信仰就很难的。我这次去美国的有些学校里面，我们这个藏传佛教里面的很深的就跟信仰非常有关系的，但是他们怎么讲啊，可能我现在这里讲也不一定让大家都明白，就是所以没有任何信仰，就是他可以研究宗教，但是呢就因为有些宗教的东西是他跟那个信仰有密切的关系，那么这个没有任何信仰的人就是对他就有研究是有非常大的这个困难。我遇到一些那个学者，就是他是也是其实犹太教跟我们这个佛教一样的，就是我们最终呢还是降到这个我，其实以前有个古老的一个学者，他说学术呢就是一直增加这个我，然后那个修道的呢就是最后就见，就是一直见到就是最后等于零的时候呢，就是他最高的这个成功。就是可能这也是一个差别。还有一个差别呢，比如说我们讲无我的时候呢，就很多学者就根本没办法，就是就无我的道理，就是他连基本的就很多都没办法懂，就这是一个。还有我们一般那个藏传佛教里面有些密法是不能随便公开的，但是他们现在有些学者呢，就是这个是没什么的，就是你就我看了里面的东西，就是不需要什么保密的，就所以有时候很难沟通。
Getting the idea that I should ask you maybe to say a few words. We don't have much time, and maybe this is a little too big, but maybe this is a better way to approach the question. And to ask you to say something about your understanding of mind and how scholarship works with the mind, just kind of more as a thinking of scholarship as a kind of condition for for just the mental continuum.
心那个过去心不可得，因为过去的心已经灭完了，就是它就像种子灭完了一样。未来的心不可得，就是它还没有产生。现在的心呢，不管是颜色、形状，从任何角度来去观察的时候，就像虚空一样的，就是从学者的角度来讲，真正的心呢，就是了不可得。所以现在的心呢，就是其实是，比如说一秒钟，就是它变成一个亿，就是然后这个所谓的现在的话，还是不成立。所以我要问哪个现在的心是到底是指的是哪一个？现在的时间是我们的这种很一个错觉，就是特别长的时间粘在一起。实际上现在确实找不到的，时间找不到，时间找不到，心也找不到。过去就把它就除开，未来就除开，然后现在到底是指的是什么？这个是我们学术的这个认识心的方法。如果是修行的认识心的方法，不用那么多的分别观察，就是自己观自己的心的时候，就知道原来心就是它。有什么不同意见吗？
I'd be interested in hearing what he has to say in the sense that one's experience of self, Buddha nature, however you would like to describe it, the only, what is experiencing that in the sense that the only tool I have to examine the experience, although when you really experience the mind is really not there. So what has the memory of the experience of the truth?
If there is a memory.
If there is a memory. what's experiencing? Yeah. Is it my mind? Is it my
nature of the body?
其实真正的这种这个体验呢就像有一个比喻，就哑巴吃汤圆，就他虽然就自己明白，但是用语言来说的话呢，就没办法就了知。他超越了一种心的这种这个有无是非的一种境界，但实际上他是也是非常符合这个实际的道理，就是他是真正的这种心的这种本体的就本来面目。就是因为本来面目已经体悟到的时候，才叫做是，这叫做是最高的、最真实的体验。所以这种体验呢，就是已经超离了，就是按照我们的这个说法的话呢，超离了这个语言，超离了这个分别思维。但这个时候呢，你就应该是就牵出了你的这种所有的这种染污。它有一个真实的体验呢，一般就是从此之后不会有任何的负面情绪，就是对你的心情就是扰乱。如果他没有到达这样的话呢，可能偶尔会产生一些负面情绪，但是不像跟以前一样的，就是虽然有一些负面情绪，但这种负面情绪呢，很快的时间当中，就像阳光下的那个水泡一样，就很快就消失。想问一下那个犹太教的这种刚才提到无我嘛，就是这个是通过怎么样每个人到达无我的境界呢，还是通过什么样的就途径来就是真的这种无我，就是想了解一下。
I would say without the word purpose, essential part of study, as opposed to academic study, a traditional study, is to find your new ideas in the past and to connect themSo there's something that's non-ego there. I'm not saying that it's getting rid of the ego. I think that might be more Buddhist. There are forms of Jewish mysticism that try to destroy get rid of the ego. But that's only certain parts, so I can't speak for it all. But in all forms, I think, of religious study, traditional study, there's a tension with the ego. Because you're trying to...find your new idea in the past. Okay, you're trying to make something cohesive.
I think he meant not to find new ideas within the old tradition, but when you think you have a new idea, to find it
actually already exist in the old tradition and then find your place within the tradition.
Within the
within
the
already existing tradition. It's not to find a new idea. I think to find
okay.
what seems to be a new idea actually already existed in the old tradition and
right.
not a new idea within the old tradition.
Okay.
And then it gives a new color
gives
rather
new
than
color.
A new presence.
Yeah, and in this sense, what you instead of developing this sense of like, wow, I'm so great, I have a new idea, to actually find that
it's already existent in
yeah,
the old tradition,
I can just find
except
a
that
new perspective of myself within
right.
this. 等于是对自我有一个新的概念，新的把握，
mm.
就是这样。但不能说
it's like a new insight that really that you really embody the teaching instead of or you really embody the tradition rather than just superficially understanding.
But you're not standing outside, which is academic.
So I guess that will be it. Join me in thanking Kenpo Lab for sharing his wisdom with us.